Next, we'll take more of your phone calls.
No, we won't.
Hey guys.
Join in on the fun with Derek and Romaine. The phone line is open to the bitches.
Put us on speed dial, bitches.
844-825-5367. That's 844-TALK-DNR.
Starting in 5, 4, 3, 2.
We could be on the line next.
1.
You're on Derek and Romaine 2.0.
Here's the story of a girl named Romaine who drank moonshine and partied with the girls. She likes sex toys in her snatch and big old titties, and she said dirty words. Here's the story of old man Derek, who watched TV and movies all day long. He would throw shade while eating pudding. He really loved the dawn. Till the one day when this lesbo met this gay boy, and they were forced to talk for hours every day. It was then they knew their show was special. That's how they became Derek and Romaine. It's Derek and Romaine. They're both insane. It's time for the Derek and Romaine show.
It's Monday. Let's go.
Yeah. What is that? Jesus Christ.
That was me coming into the show with excitement, Derek.
Ooh, nobody's prepared for that, sweetie.
What? Yes, they are.
I don't know.
We're not. Who knows? Who can say? Who can say?
Hi. Hello.
How are you?
I am terrific, and I'm sure the listeners are in a terrific mood to have us back. You know, the weekends can be so long without Derek and Romaine. So long.
Farewell.
But here we are. You can give us a jingle, of course, 844-TALK-DNR. We have 6 hookers already on the hotline, which is great for a Monday, July 18th.
Yes, that's right. Today's my sister Sabina's birthday.
I saw that. I wished your sister, Sabina Berkshire Hathaway, a very happy birthday.
Well, that was very nice of you. I have not.
I didn't realize she had changed her last name to a corporation, but good for her.
That's her real estate account. That's the one where she can't put all of her dumb points of view on.
Oh, well, no wonder that's where I want to be friends with her.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I have also changed my name. My name now legally is Derek Hostess Twinkies. Thank you. Please respect my privacy.
Oh, that's a great name. I like that name. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It says everything I want you to know about what I'm looking for in life.
I can support looking for that in life, actually. I think that
is a Hostess Twinkie, or do you have a box of Hostess Twinkies you can bring by?
Neither. I have neither. I have some snow donuts.
But it's not snowing.
Well, it's raining. It's practically the same thing. Isn't it?
Almost.
Isn't it? Mostly. It's been quite a day here in New Jersey. I don't know about where you're at up there in New York, but here in New Jersey, we've had off and on monsoons all day long. There's been loud thunder and lightning and then torrential downpours.
Yeah,
now we have a light breeze. It's actually quite an eventful day in the weather here in New Jersey.
Well, as you know, longtime listeners, Team Steven and Team Cyrus moved in to my neighborhood some months ago and then completely forgot I lived here.
Yep.
And anyway, they had been gone. I mean, I don't want to tell their story, but anyway, but they had been out of town for a number of days. And when they came back, because, you know, it hasn't rained here before today, apparently, for almost 6 weeks.
Praise Jeebus.
And it's been, you know, it's summer. It's been hot. And then it hasn't rained for 6 weeks. And they came back and they're like, oh, my God, everybody's lawn is dead.
Well, yeah, that does happen when you don't get a lot of rain.
Well, so I think a lot of people are like me. I mean, I do have a neighbor who has a, like, toxic, glow-in-the-dark, vibrant green lawn.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what nuclear material he's pouring onto it to get it that green. It's beautiful. Don't get me wrong. He has a gorgeous, gorgeous lawn. But I'm so afraid of a cancer cluster around his front yard because that's not natural. What's happening on his lawn is not normal. But it's beautiful, but scary.
It's not right. It's not okay.
It's too green.
We have a neighbor like that who clearly dumps a shit ton of money into making their lawn very green.
Which, you know, if that's what you're into, great. But I'm just, I look at it and it scares me because it doesn't look right. Anyway. So, but other than that, most people in my neighborhood don't routinely water their lawns because we get a fair amount. I mean, we'll get snow in the winter and then we get a fair amount of rain in the spring. And even in the summer, we'll get the occasional rainstorm and everything. So very rarely do I ever think, oh, I should water the lawn because it's looking awfully bad. So I think what happens is it sneaks up on all of us. We just assume, well, it's a little dry, but it'll rain in a couple of days. Right. And then you turn around and it's been 6 weeks and your lawn is dead. But my lawn looks very dead right now.
Not mine. Mine looks beautiful.
I was grateful for the rain. I needed it.
Yeah, my lawn looks amazing, but it always kind of does. And we don't really do anything to take care of it. We just kind of cut it when it needs to be cut. And that's about it. And I think our neighbors hate us because they know how little work we actually put into the lawn. But it looks, I mean, the front lawn anyway looked really good. The back lawn was starting to dry out a little bit. But the front lawn looked really, it looked really sharp. So I wasn't too stressed out or worried about it. But yeah, the rain is nice. I mean, I hate the rain. I'm not a big fan of rain. Because I just feel like, I mean, the only nice thing about a rainy day is that it's a perfect day to take a nap, right? Because then it's like gloomy outside, so it's not real light outside. And the pitter patter of the rain kind of helps lull you off to sleep. So that's about the only good quality of a rainy day, in my opinion.
I like the noise of the rain hitting an air conditioning window unit while you're trying to do a radio show. I think that's my favorite part.
I mean, that is a sound, and luckily for you, I can't hear it, so you're fine.
Oh, no, it's not actually actively raining here, so it's not happening.
Well, I was just saying, because I don't hear anything. You're good. But no, that is disturbing when that happens. I remember when we had the old studio, and that had, oh, God, that was the worst. It was like popcorn popping while you're doing the show. It's real, y'all. But we don't have to worry about that today. We don't have to worry about that at all. So, Derek, I don't know about you, but I had a very fun weekend. My favorite part of the weekend was Sunday morning when I was in my bed, sound asleep. Oh, I was so... Now, I had gotten up in the middle of the night. I'd gotten up in the middle of the night that night to pee, as I do, and on my way back, I stepped into something wet and disgusting, and I was grossed out. And I turned on the hall light so I could see what it was, and I had stepped into a pile of cat puke.
Oh, great.
And I was like,
there's nothing better than moist carpet.
Right, and I was just like, this is disgusting. So I had to go back to the bathroom and like wash off my foot in the bathtub. Because it was like between my toes. It was disgusting. And I was like, oh, thanks, cats. You're the best. So then I went back to bed after cleaning things up, went back to bed and went back to sleep. And I was, so sound asleep. It was just I was having beautiful dreams. And it was, you know, whatever, 8 a.m. And I'm dreaming. And Iris is like huffing and puffing next to me. She's like, And I'm like, finally, I roll over and I'm like, what the fuck is your problem? And she's like, hi. Huh? And I'm like, oh, my God, you can't even talk. And she goes, well, I rolled over to put something on my bedside table. And I saw something. And I was like, okay. And I'm thinking, oh, great. The cat puked over there and I just missed that. And I'm like, okay, well, why do I care? Like, why are you waking me up? Because it was clear she was trying to wake me up. I think there's a dead mouse beside the bed. And I'm like, no. And I'm like, then get up and throw it away. I can't do that. I can't do that. I was like, why? It's a dead mouse. I can't go near a dead mouse. I'm terrified of a dead mouse. I'm like, oh, my God. So I get up. I go grab the fucking dead mouse by its dead dumb tail, walk it 3 feet into the trash can and throw it away. And I go back to bed. And then she didn't even let me go back to sleep. She's like, you got to get up now. And I'm like, why? She goes, oh, we're going to go have coffee down at the down to the farm for breakfast today. We're going to go down and have coffee at the farm. So then we got up and we went down to the farm and we sat on their amazing deck. Oh, God, I love their deck so much. It's honestly, I think their deck is the most amazing part of their property because you sit on it. It's kind of elevated and it looks out over all like the horse paddocks. It's just fucking beautiful. Like, it's so beautiful. So we went down with our coffee. We took our coffee down and we sat on the deck with Brian and Christy and we had the most lovely coffee. And I'm telling you, that is the way to start a day. Oh, coffee, the sound of nature, the horses running around, being silly, good company. Yeah. Oh, it was gorgeous. Gorgeous. I had a gorgeous weekend. That's what I'm saying. My weekend was great. How was yours?
Well, we had a house full of people, and then I also had plans out of the house. So,
I'm sorry,
you know,
what?
Mike and Brian.
You left the house
John
on a weekend?
Jeremy and Adam from Sissy Town up to the house.
Oh, that's nice.
Gameplay and cheese.
Yeah.
And then our listeners, Christopher and Mark.
Oh, I love those
had
two.
Invited us a couple of months ago to see a Broadway show. Just turned out it was the same weekend. And I agreed to go and Romaine, you know, she had to sleep in. So
no, it wasn't that. It's convincing Iris to go into the city on a weekend is actually, it's like pulling teeth. It's very, very hard to do. If it was up to me, I would go to all of these things, but my wife says no. So I have to listen to my wife, even though it bums me out because I would rather be hanging out with fun people. But alas, it's okay. I try not. Like the few times she does decide we can go into the city and hang out and have fun with friends, I enjoy those. That's just how it is. Iris is the boss, you know. I know everyone thinks I'm the boss, but Iris is really the boss.
Well, good for her, I guess.
Yeah. So you went in and saw everybody, and what'd you guys do?
So Chris got tickets to see Into the Woods. So there was a here in New York City, they have all the Broadway theaters with the Broadway shows and everything. And then they have a theater called City Center, which is not Broadway. It is it's a theater company that does basically something more than a concert version of a Broadway show. They don't do full mountings of shows.
Okay.
But they do, what they do is it will have like the orchestra and they'll do the show, but it will have sort of very minimal staging. They don't do a lot of sets and the costumes are fairly like minimal. It's only for a short run. They'll do, you know, an 8-week, 10-week.
And is this like a trial thing to like see if a show will actually work for Broadway?
So what most of them are at City Center are revivals of shows that are not frequently revived.
Okay.
Or maybe it will be a show that did not previously run on Broadway, but was an off-Broadway hit. And then they might do like a version of it. But like at City Center, I've seen a couple of different things. One of the things that I saw at City Center was Applause, which is a musical from 1970, right. I want to say, that is a musical version of All About Eve.
Okay.
And I think that Lauren Bacall starred in the original Broadway production in 1970. And then the character of Birdie Margot Channing's assistant is a gay man. I don't know if in Applause it was a gay man or if they just changed it to a gay man, but Billy Porter played the role when it was at City Center. And so it's a good place to see a show that is not regularly done.
Okay.
And they'll put on performances, but sometimes they'll put on something like Into the Woods, which not only has been done on Broadway more than once, but also is quite popular to do in high schools and middle schools and that kind of thing. But most of the time when they do it in middle schools and high schools, they only do the first act.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
So if you saw the movie version that came out whenever that was, 8 years ago, 7 years ago, with Meryl Streep and Emily Blunt and James Corden and his gayness.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
Yeah, we all remember that. Anyway, so the second half of the show is quite dark. So the first half of Into the Woods, it's sort of a riff on classic fairy tales, Little Red Riding Hood and Cinderella and that kind of thing.
Right.
Where all of them are basically in one storybook land. And the first half of the show, and Jack and the Beanstalk, and the first half of the show is really... They all wish for something, and then at the end of Act One, all their wishes have come true.
Oh. Lovely. So that's a positive story. And then what
happens? Would be a positive. But then in the second act, the sort of consequences of their wishes come true. And then it becomes much more of a cautionary tale of sort of be careful what you wish for. And and so it's dark. And about half the cast dies in Act Two. It's rough.
Oh, wow.
I'm just going to say, I can understand why for like middle schoolers, it's the first half is fun because it's, you know.
All your wishes come true. Yay. Well,
not only that, but it's just a modern take on fairy tales.
Right.
And so, and you know, for teens or tweens to play Jack of Jack and the Beanstalk or Little Red Riding Hood or The Baker and His Wife or The Witch. Like, it's fine. It's fun.
Sure.
And then you don't have to deal with the darker ramifications of Act Two. And anyway, so they did this production, City Center, with big stars in it. Sarah Bareilles and Patina Miller, who's a big Broadway star. She's not necessarily a household name, although she was on, I want to say, Madam Secretary.
Okay.
There are all these Broadway people who have these incredible Broadway voices and everything. And then they're like fourth billed on a network show and you have no idea how talented they are. But apparently she had some role on Madam Secretary. And so she's the witch and Sarah Bareilles is the baker's wife. And Brian D'Arcy James, who's a big Broadway star, who's not a like necessarily a household name. He's been on other TV shows and everything. But he was in Shrek. He played Shrek in Shrek.
Okay.
And he played the baker. Gavin Creel, who's crazy hot,
yes,
plays Cinderella's Prince and the Wolf, but he was out when I saw it. But my friend Alex in Los Angeles, his friend, who's like a swing on the show, he was filling in. He did quite a good job, and he apparently fills in for everybody.
Oh.
Like, last week, he was filling in for the baker. This week, he's the prince. I'm like, dang.
It's a lot of roles to know.
Some versatility.
Yeah.
Yeah. When I got there, I was on time, by the way. When I got there, it was a huge line because it's a big theater, 1,700 people. So there was a long line to get in. And literally the people were like, is this the line for the Sarah Bareilles concert? It was straight up Sarah Bareilles super fans.
Well, she does have a huge production following.
Yeah.
So that's not surprising.
So this was all at City Center, and it was a huge hit at City Center in like because it was a pared down production, and people really enjoyed the production without a lot of the sort of special effects and things, the big effects,
right,
that usually go along with the show, and so you really can just sort of hear the music and great performances. And because City Center does a shorter run, they can get gigantic stars because they are not committing to, you know, 2 years of a show.
Right.
So like Sarah Bareilles is free in between seasons of Girls 5 Eva. So she could do, you know, 8 weeks at City Center or whatever else. Anyway, so they get gigantic stars to do the shows at City Center, which is another reason to go. And it was such a hit at City Center. And then Broadway has had trouble filling theaters. And normally there's a 2 to 3 year wait for a theater to open up on Broadway. But this summer, there were several houses that were empty for a few months until other shows were coming in the fall. So City Center did a deal to transfer the production to Broadway for, I think, only 10 weeks.
Right.
And that way it'll fill the Broadway house. The actors who are otherwise free can keep doing, you know, the show over the summer, although a lot of them have been taking somewhat generous vacation time off from the show.
Sure.
But there's so many stars in the show. Like Gavin Creel wasn't there, but there were four other named stars in the show. So it was fine. I mean, I miss Gavin Creel because he's not only handsome, but incredibly talented.
Right.
As a singer. But anyway. But I saw, we saw the show. The tickets that Chris got were second row center.
Oh, lovely.
Like, here's how close we were to the stage. And Romaine will understand as an audiophile. We were in the pocket between the stage and the speakers. So I did not hear amplified voices while they were singing. I heard the people on stage singing.
Right.
That's how close we were.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways it was. In other ways, it was like the orchestra is loud. And, you know, normally that's fine because they are projecting the voices of the singers. But, like, I had trouble with some of the lyrics. And I know after all these years of doing radio, I'm a bit hard of hearing.
No.
So I missed quite a bit of the lyrics. But it was fine.
Well, that's pretty fucking cool. Sounds like a great show. Sounds like you guys had a good time.
It was, it's a really, really good production. And I had never seen Into the Woods, like staged. I saw the movie version and I liked the movie fine. And, but it was really a lovely production, funny and heartfelt. And Patina Miller sang the fucking shit out of that show.
Well, good.
And then Sarah Bareilles too, like beautiful. And Brian D'Arcy James has an incredible voice and, just, you know, so much talent. Everybody was great. Oh, and I totally forgot. Philippa Sue, who was in Hamilton, she played the younger sister that he doesn't marry.
Oh, okay.
And she plays Cinderella. And I thought, I mean, it was tough because Patina Miller was really a showstopper. But I thought Philippa Sue was incredible. Really, really. In... because like Hamilton, I think the female roles are kind of a downer.
A little bit, yeah.
And I also, I find them a bit of an also-ran in the show.
Right.
Not that they, and part of it is, you know, in history, you know, the creation of America, the women were obviously in the backseat because they ended up getting nothing out of the Constitution. But even still, I just felt like it's not, they don't get the best parts of the show. In Hamilton, even though they're all very talented.
They sure don't. And they were super talented.
Yeah. But Philippa Sue playing Cinderella in like a very like a lighter and more charming, fun, you know, she's Cinderella. I just found her delightful, effervescent and lovely. Steve and Cyrus are walking by the house right now.
Effervescent. Outside.
They didn't even look over.
Oh.
They don't even care.
They don't care.
So anyway, whatever. I saw them yesterday.
Who's stalking who now, Derek? Ooh, creepy, creepy. Derek Hartley.
They don't even. They don't even know that we're here. They don't even look. They don't even notice.
They know. They know. I mean, I think they know. I don't know. Anyway, well, I sounds like I might be a little jealous. It sounds like you had a wonderful time, and it sounds like the show was really good.
You would have really liked the production.
You're probably right. You know, I love going to see shows. It's always, why I'm bummed out. And Iris hates it, hates it more than life itself. Like, getting Iris to go to a Broadway show is even harder than getting her to go to the city on the weekends. She hates it. She really fucking hates it, which is a bummer because, you know, Romy and I love it. But, you know, it is what it is. I will survive. I will. I will. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm jealous. That's all I have to say about that. That's all I have to say about that.
An opportunity to go and you decided not to.
I know. Well, you know, I don't want my wife to hate me. I do want to talk about what I did. So over the weekend, I caught up, by the way, on Big Brother. Big Brother. Derek, we should talk about this show. Yeah. Because, wow. I don't know what's happening over there at the Big Brother soundstage, but they are a fucking mess.
Yeah.
Wow. Like, you had said that, oh, yeah, things are going to get real messy. I was like, oh, yeah, okay, sure, whatever. By the way, we might spoil some shit. So if you haven't caught up with Sunday's episode, whatever. You've been warned. Okay.
There isn't much that's particularly spoilery about Sunday's episode.
No, not really.
It was just who gets HOH and then who got put up. But that's not... I mean, the real shit was what went down last week. Oh. Like, that's the real messy...
So first thoughts on this cast, now that I've watched a few episodes and I have a better sense of who they are. I'm not sure I like most of them. There's a couple that I kind of like, but I'm not even sure I like them yet. So far, the lesbian is going to continue to be my favorite one, and not because she's a lesbian, but because she seems to, A, be the least obnoxious, and she at least seems to have her shit somewhat together compared to everybody else. I find the girls on the show to be so fucking annoying. I hate all of them. Either they cry too much, or they whine too much, or they're super paranoid too much, or crazy too much. And then the boys, meh. I find half of them super obnoxious, and the other half I just don't care about. So far, the lesbian's my favorite. That's the point I'm trying to make. What are your thoughts now that you've watched the cast a little bit more?
Well, my feelings have not really changed about the cast of Big Brother. I thought that Paloma was kind of a sneaky bitch.
Kind of? Totally
then
was.
She just evaporated. So I'm like, well, I mean, I feel bad for the show editors who are like, oh, hooray, we've got our villain of the season.
She was going to be the villain of the season.
She really was a manipulative
twat. Oh, my God. I could not believe how manipulative she was. I'm like, she straight up lied to people.
Yeah.
And then act all innocent. And then go to him and be like, I'm here for you, girl. I'm your best friend. And I'm like, bitch, you are literally stabbing the knife in her front, her back, and the sides. I mean, I kind of loved her psycho crazy bitchness, but... And here's my question. So, Paloma had she melted down and had some mental issues that forced her out of the game. Do they not do any kind of psychological screening before these fucking, they get cast on this show? Because, like, I mean, clearly the issues here, like the anxiety and things like that, like, those are clear known issues. How is it that they didn't, that, I mean, because it was a mess. Like, it's just a mess. Like, it just seems like this production, you know, they got people falling down, twisting their ankles. The audio, oh, don't even get started on the audio on that show. Our audience thinks our audio is bad from time to time. Watch an episode of fucking Big Brother, which, by the way, is produced by a major corporation. They can't get their shit together at all.
We're produced by a minor corporation.
Yeah, micro. Anyway, I just don't understand how Paloma even got cast on the show. I mean, I get it. She's a crazy psycho bunny who could have been a great villain, but they didn't have better options? Do you think she kept it from them?
It's, yeah. It, apparently, she was taking some kind of medication, and she didn't tell them, and she didn't bring it with her, and then after a week of not taking her mood stabilizers, she started crashing.
Oh my God, this is Survivor, straight up, exactly the same thing that happened on Survivor this season.
Yeah.
Ugh, annoying. All right, let's go to the phone, because Jonathan in Nashville is on the line. Hi, Jonathan.
Hello. So with Danny, the first HOH, he claims to be a super fan, but with him targeting Michael, of all people, just because he's another super fan, that doesn't seem like super fan moves. Like, that really seems like the person you would probably want to initially work with and then target later, because he wasn't, like, a competition threat. He was the scrawniest dude ever.
I agree. I totally agree.
Yeah, and thank God he won veto, because I really like the Michael dude. I think he's a decent guy, seems like. And then regarding Paloma, I didn't know... I just learned from y'all about her mood stabilizers or whatever, which makes sense, I guess. But I was thinking that she probably realized she was going to get caught in her lie that Taylor had said, you know, X, Y, and Z in a different way than she really did. and then maybe she started worrying about how the edit would look later. But because she just went from normal to crazy real quick, which I guess that makes sense now. But like there was no way she wouldn't have been found out that she was kind of exaggerating what Taylor said. And Taylor, I think she was threatened by Taylor as well, because Taylor is a very confident person, and being herself is hanging with the guys, maybe. And I think that Paloma just wanted to be the sex kitten of the season and wasn't being able to do that because Taylor was so confident and taking over that kind of role with the guys. And I feel there was a lot of jealousy from Paloma toward Taylor, which kind of led to all of the drama there.
Oh, I agree with that. I think there was a lot. I think that Taylor made Paloma feel very insecure. I agree about the whole like sex appeal thing. I think she kind of took that away from her, and that just all played into it. But I was surprised at how quickly she like just devolved, like from being like a pretty confident player to just being a hot fucking mess. Although I got to be honest, if I were in a room sleeping with five or six people and three or four of them snored, I wouldn't get an ounce of sleep. I know I wouldn't. I'd be up all night long. Every night I'd be like fucking Kathy Poncer on a cruise, drugging myself and getting super drunk until I can pass out so I don't hear snoring. Like that, I would be doing that because I don't know how I would survive.
Yeah. I mean, or go sleep on the couch. You know, I mean, if you're that starved.
Yeah, but I think they leave the lights on. I think they leave the lights on in like the main areas of the house, and only the bedroom is where it gets dark at night. I could be wrong. No,
I mean, I can wear a sleep mask. I could wear a sleep mask.
Yeah, I could too. But
yeah. Anyway, all right. That was all. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Jonathan. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, I think this season's gonna be messy. I agree with the stuff about the two hardcore fans. I don't understand taking out another hardcore fan. I would keep them close, at least for the first half of the game. Because they're going to know things. They're going to have advantages that non-hardcore players are going to, the things they're going to miss out on. So I don't know. The gameplay is
strange. Here's the problem with, because I understand the idea of, oh, these people are super fans. They're going to be the most dangerous because they're going to know the game best. Big Brother has been on the air now for almost 25 years. Who doesn't know how the game works now? That this to me just feels like an excuse to get rid of somebody because you think they might be some kind of power player. But as one of the people pointed out on the show last night, like everybody's here to win money. Everybody knows how the game works. Nobody is like, oh, I've got to save so and so because they're a nice person. That's nobody is here for that. So the idea that, oh, so-and-so's a super fan, we can't keep them around. Any reason to get rid of anyone, especially like the first two episodes, the whiff of anything is enough to send somebody out the door. Because sure, everybody is in better them than me mode at the beginning.
Did you think that the tears that were shed for Paloma leaving were real or just fakey-fakey?
Well, I think it was real in the sense of it's one thing for some. I think they knew that she had been emotionally struggling.
Right.
Because there were some talk about that of like, oh, she's napping a lot and she doesn't seem okay. And it wasn't. I got a pretty clear sense because she didn't even have like a goodbye thing in the diary room. I think, you know, she just went into the diary room. Like, people didn't even know she went in the diary room. And then she just never came back.
Oh, I agree. I think that's totally what happened.
Yeah. And so I think people were upset that they didn't even get a chance to say goodbye or, you know, because some, I mean, I know in the Big Brother house, like, all they do is sit around and yak all day. But I'm sure if they had known she was leaving, they would have liked to have said goodbye or something because she was obviously in a rough place. I think that they would have liked to have at least said, you know,
Do you think
it's a game and you seem like a nice person, whatever, everything's going to be okay on the outside. I don't think they wanted anybody like,
do you think she left voluntarily?
Yeah. But in another way, I think that they were probably relieved. Because then they didn't have to worry about themselves going home.
Yeah, I'm not convinced that she left voluntarily. I think she...
You think production just pulled her?
Production might have pulled her. Well, I mean, she was clearly melting down. Like, she was clearly... I mean, even with what they showed, it was pretty obvious that she was falling apart. And I think production probably sent somebody in to talk to her. And then, you know, this revelation came out about the medication she wasn't taking. And I think they probably pulled her for health reasons, very similar to what they did with Survivor.
Yeah.
So
now this is a whispered thing about her having some kind of medication that she did not disclose to production, because I don't think that they could say
right
something like that, because it would be a HIPAA violation.
Well, I mean, yes, exactly, because on Survivor, if you remember when Jeff Probst showed up to pull the guy off of Survivor, the guy is the one who said, well, I've been taking, I think it was like lithium or something like that, and then I thought I could wean myself off of it. So, yeah, because Jeff wasn't going to, and Jeff even said, oh, I wasn't going to say what it was or anything like that. You know, and for exactly that reason, for HIPAA violation stuff. So I think, I don't think they were going to tell us that publicly. They probably had to protect that for Paloma's sake. But yeah, it's going to be a messy season. My point is, I cannot believe what a messy season it's going to be, from, injuries on the set, which, by the way, I don't know how you injure yourself jumping a foot down, but okay. All these, I love at one point in time during one of them, they're like, fucking Julie Chen was like, you guys need to hurry. We're almost out of time, as they were doing like the HOH, like competition or whatever, because they had to take an unexpected break. Like production's a mess. It's a fucking mess over there at Big Brother. I can't believe how messy it is, honestly, from audio issues to, I mean, you name it. It's just, I mean, even Julie Chen is like, what the fuck is happening here?
Yeah, you can tell that they were like clear. And you know what? I, as I say all the time on the show, I have a lot of sympathy for people who work live, because we work live, and sometimes shit happens while you're working live. There's nothing you can do about it. It just happens.
It sucks when it happens too.
And, but yeah, in this case, it's like it is off to a really rough start. And it's not even just the cast, like everything about it just feels like production wasn't ready to begin this season. And you know, they had somebody, Joseph, the hot lawyer.
Yeah.
He was a last minute sub in because the person who was supposed to be on the show, like, bailed during the pre-production part, right before they were supposed to be released. I don't know if he like tested positive for COVID or changed his mind or whatever, but Joseph was a last minute substitution.
Wow.
I mean, I'm sure the producers are glad because he's super hot and he never wears a shirt, but even still, it just feels like this whole season they've been up against it with any number of problems.
Yeah. Well, I guess we'll wait and see. I'll be watching my Big Brother as the weeks go, and we'll see how it goes. But oh man, I really need to be on that show. I think I'd be really good on that show. But here's my worry. I just think I'd get so bored. I think I'd gain 150 pounds while on that show, because I'd be so bored I'd just eat all the time. And then my love of naps would also probably be a bit of a problem. I'd either be napping or eating or napping. That would be bad. But I'd love to do that show. I think it'd be fun. Yeah. I did watch another show over the weekend, though. Iris and I started a new show on Apple TV called...
You can't even keep up with the shows you have as it is.
What are you talking about?
Also, I've given you recommended of things you should be watching, and you're like, oh, yeah, we're going to get to that. Now what have you started?
You mean Kung Fu? Yes. I don't even know. Where is it streaming?
It's on the CW.
Yeah, but where does it stream? Is it on Hulu?
I don't know that it streams
on the
anywhere. Maybe, well, then the that's... maybe Paramount Plus?
Because at this point, I only watch streaming shows, basically.
Of course. You're so young, Romaine.
I just don't watch... I mean, what am I going to do? Record it in my DVR? That's the old way of doing things. I barely ever watch live TV. Like, really, unless it's the news. I will watch live TV in the form of news, and that's about it. Everything else, I almost entirely just moved over to streaming. But the new show we started watching is on Apple TV called Truth Be Told. And I have to say, it's really good. It's kind of like this, it's a murder mystery kind of show. It's got a great cast, and it's the first season I liked better than the second season. I'm not done with the second season yet. We're still watching it. But the second season seems a little bit messy and like they've lost a little bit of direction. But the first season, it's kind of a whodunit mystery, and it's played out by essentially a podcaster. So they're doing like a true crime podcast. And it's kind of in the way, it's kind of like Only Murders in the Building, where as the season goes, you learn a little bit more. But yeah. So anyway, it's good. I really like it. So.
And that's what? Apple Plus?
Apple Plus. Yeah. It's got, who's the actress in it? The one who baked the pie in The Help. Spencer. What's her first name?
Octavia Spencer.
Thank you, Octavia. She's in it, and she's great. She's really good in it. I really like her in it. So, anyway, I recommend that one because it's great, and I'm enjoying it.
And yet, you don't watch Tehran.
I have not watched that one yet. No. Uh-huh, I got, listen.
Uh-huh. No, I understand. Hold on. I make these recommendations for you and then you ignore them and then you
I also could out. Only
No, it's when
I this is a this is an Iris and I show that we just started. So it's I have to also interest Iris in these shows. It can't just be about what I want to watch. Heller. Trust me, if it was all about what I want to watch, I'd have a whole bunch of shows I'd be watching. But it's not like that. Not like that. At all. But I do think you'd like this show that I'm watching, Truth Be Told.
All right. Well, Kung Fu may be on HBO Max.
Oh, okay. Maybe.
I think that's where it is. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Well, over the weekend, there was big celebrity news.
There was? What kind of news was
that? Ben Affleck and Jennifer Lopez got married in Las Vegas.
Okay.
And they're at like midnight and their kids were their witnesses and Jennifer Lopez is changing her name.
She is.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
To Jennifleck.
Well, good for her.
She is changing her name to Jennifer Lynn Affleck.
Well, listen, these two kids have clearly held a flame for each other for a very long time, 21 years. I think... You know, I'm hopeful for Jennifer more than him. I am hopeful that this is the marriage that is meant to be, that is going to last. She clearly loves this guy. And so I'm, you know what, I'm happy for her. And if she wants to change her name, maybe this is the sign of it's real, y'all, to her, then I say it's great. I'm excited for these kids. I love that they kind of ran off and eloped, essentially. I like that they're kind of just playing by their own rules and doing things that they want to do. I think it's good. I'm all about it.
I like it. And, you know, I agree. They dated almost 20 years ago.
Yep.
They know what they're getting themselves into. I think, you know, two people who date when they're 30, let's say, versus the same two people who date when they're 50.
Right.
You know, I think this might actually last just because they have both lived a lot of life since then.
Yeah.
They both dated other people. They know what they want in life and they know, you know, they know what all this is. I think this is a good sign. And I am surprised. Like, her changing her name.
That's kind of a big deal for her. I don't know what
that means legally.
Well, I mean, it's going to be her legal name, but I'm sure her performing name, she'll continue to go by J-Lo forever.
There's no reason for her to not continue to be Jennifer Lopez professionally. But I did find it interesting that she has been married many times, but this is the first time that she's said that she's changing her name.
Right. I mean, listen, I just think these guys, you're right. I think at the age that they're at, I think they know what it is they're looking for. I think they know what it is they want. I think they've always kind of held a candle for each other. Even though, you know, in the in-between time, I mean, he got married, had kids. Like, I just feel like they know what, I think, you know, they found themselves back in love with each other again. And, you know, not very many couples get a second chance. And I think a big part of why they broke up the first time was not so much that they didn't love each other. I just think that the public pressure was just too fucking much. I mean, I remember what it was like the first time they were dating, and they were like Brad and Angelina. They couldn't go fucking anywhere. They couldn't do anything without a camera in their face. And I think, you know, I don't know if it's that, you know, maybe they're just not as interesting now as they were then, but it seems like that pressure isn't the same now as it was then. People care a little bit less than they did then. And maybe that's just taking off that pressure from their relationship is what will allow it to thrive. I hope so.
I hope so too. I wish them both happiness, and if this is going to make them happy, great.
But also, both of their exes seem really okay with them being back together. Like, you know, Jennifer Garner has been very supportive of him dating J-Lo again, and has publicly said as much. And even A-Rod, you know, I think is handling this really well and wishing the best for them. So it seems to me that even the people that they've loved since Loving One Another, I think they always knew that this was there and that this was meant to be.
Well, Jennifer Garner still has her Capital One money. And A-Rod has continued to date younger and younger female pop stars.
Yeah.
I assume next on his list is, I don't know, Doja Cat? I have no idea. It's just somebody who's a teenager now.
Probably.
That he could date.
Who is he? R. Kelly?
Well, I'm just saying, like, he keeps dating very famous women. I don't think he's going to have trouble finding another famous woman to be in a relationship.
Absolutely
with. Not. And then there's always Madonna. Maybe he'll get back together with sweet old Madonna.
Oh, I'm sure Madonna wants him back. No, she likes him young now, too. He's too old for her, I think, now.
Good for both of them. Well, and you know, and Chris Evans has apparently...
Ooh, he's got laser focus on his relationships.
Yeah.
He wants a wife. A wifey wife.
Yeah, probably.
It's not a husband he's looking for, unfortunately.
No. He definitely is not gay. He's not looking for a man. He has a gay brother. He's very supportive of the LGBTQ community. I think if he were gay, he would have told us, especially now that he's got his Captain America money. What does he care? He's got nothing to lose. But I think it is... because it has been this sort of question mark with Chris Evans of like, why is he single?
I think he's been really wrapped up in his career. I mean, his career for the last, whatever, decade has been huge.
Yeah, I actually think, he has been dating. I think the real thing about Chris Evans is he is not a out on the town paparazzi guy. And I feel like most of the women that he has dated are women that he met on movie sets. I think he's just a homebody. And then,
I mean, you're probably not wrong.
And then I think he's very close to his mom. And I think it's a thing of like, well, I can't date anyone my mother won't approve of. And God only knows, maybe she has very high standards.
I mean, yes. But also, I think in this way, he's a very normal guy who just wants a normal girl and maybe not someone who's associated with Hollywood and all that. But as you know, and I mean, really anyone who's ever been in the public eye, Rosie's talked about this a lot, actually, as well. It's very hard to date a normal, and when I say a normal person, I mean a non-famous person. It's very hard to find a non-famous person to date if you're a famous person who can roll with the lifestyle of being in a famous couple, because it changes things, whether you want it to or not. It does. It changes the parameters of your relationship and how things have to be done. And there are certain expectations that come with fame and things like that. And it, and the average person is not built or equipped to handle that. So if what you're looking for is a relationship with a normal person, you got to find that needle in a haystack, that one person who can not only tolerate all the crazy shit that comes with fame, but embrace it and flow with it in a way that, you know, works. And that is a high bar, honestly, I think, to find. But I think that's ultimately what he wants. I think he wants a normal, non-famous girlfriend who's going to make him happy, but who can roll with this life that he's chosen for himself.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. I just think it's a tall order. And he clearly, he works all the time, so he can't meet somebody outside of his day-to-day work routine. And I think he has dated some actresses and whatever, but he doesn't seem to be interested in the spotlight. Also, I don't even think he lives in Los Angeles. I think he lives up in Boston. Like, I think he lives, like,
yeah, I think you're right. Away. I think you're right.
And that's probably a hindrance, too. Even if he, you know, wanted to date whatever, some actress, she doesn't live local to him, and then he right. would have to, then they're what, dating long distance? I think there are a lot of barriers here. He has a dog. He seems really attached to his dog.
Well, yeah, because he doesn't have a girlfriend.
Well, yeah, but also, I mean, he feels like one of these dog guys. Like, the dog is the priority.
Yeah, he's a bachelor.
Yeah, it's hard for a woman. You can't date somebody long distance if you have a dog that needs you every day.
That's right, because you got to be there for your dog.
Right, got to be there for the dog. Right. The dog takes precedent. Mm-hmm. A lot of women don't like it when a man chooses the dog over them.
Well, tough
shit. I'm guessing.
Shit.
Yeah. But I'm sure that there are all sorts of women who would line up to date Chris Evans.
Of
Maybe
course.
He should go on The Bachelor.
Oh, God, that's horrible. That is not how he, that's not how he's going to find a wife. Derek.
I actually think that this is not a terrible idea.
I think this is a horrible idea.
Well, he's just very, he seems like a more private person. I don't think he would want to go on The Bachelor. But ultimately, I think what he should do is he should do what Julia Roberts did. Julia Roberts married a cameraman, Danny Motor. So it's somebody who's in the business.
Yep.
He understands production.
Sure.
Like the being like having to be overseas for 3 months at a time and whatever else. But he's not a famous person. So they're not sort of in competition as fame people.
Right.
And I think it also helped for Julia Roberts that when she met him, she was over the hump of her rom-com part of her fame. You know, she yeah. was in her 30s and there was less work and she had made a lot of money. And I think she, like, it just, it hit at the right time.
Right.
She wanted to have some kids. She wanted to work less. And then she found somebody who could understand what working meant.
Right.
And could be supportive of that. And it helps that her husband is also super hot.
Well, that's just it. Chris Evans has to find a super hot chick because he can't date some fugly. Like, that would not be acceptable in society. I mean, I hate to say it, but it's true. You're right. I think it'll be very hard to find someone, I think, who works in the industry, especially in like the back end of the industry. Because let's be honest, it's a very a man dominated industry.
Right. There are just fewer women to find.
Right. Yeah.
Also, I mean, he says he wants to find somebody that he can live with. That is the big thing is, you know, he's 40 now and you get real set in your ways later in life.
Oh, tell me about it.
And I mean, look, I have faced this. You know, you go home with somebody and you look at their apartment and, you know, before it's like, oh, they're hot, blah, 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 whatever. I'm having sex with them. You know, fine. And then you leave the next day. Now you go over to somebody's house and then you're like looking at their furniture, like, could I live with that lamp?
Let me
ask. Is that couch a deal breaker?
Yes, it is.
And that's the problem. It's like, yeah, I can't live with your, I don't like your taste of furniture. I can't live with you. There's no place for your furniture in my house.
I got to be honest. If I was judging Iris by the taste of her house, like, and the things she had in it when we first started dating, and maybe I should have paid more attention to this, we would not still be dating because Iris has pretty horrible taste. Like, I hated the way Iris had her house decorated. Everything about it. I hated it. I hated it so much. And it took me a long time to slowly get rid of all of her crap and replace it with better crap. Because it was bad. So tacky. Oh, it was so bad. But she never had anyone help her with any of that. And she does not have a designer's eye. Whereas I, well, my taste in clothing is definitely bad. And when it comes to home furnishings, I have some taste. Only because I have an interior designer for a brother who yells at me if I pick ugly things. So I had a little bit of an advantage over poor Iris. But yeah, living with someone is hard. I got to be honest, if Iris and I ever broke up, I can't see myself living with anybody else because I'd hate it.
Yeah. See, it's hard.
Yeah.
Living with another person is hard.
In fact, there's only other than fucking a lot of women, the only other thing I miss about being single is living alone. Like, I really miss the personal freedom of living alone and the quiet aspects of living alone. Like, I miss that a lot because I really did love it. Like, I loved it. I know.
Well, and this is the thing. If you two divorce, you'll really love being bachelor dad. Oh, it's going to be great.
Are you kidding?
High pants on every other weekend. Great.
Every other weekend. I got 3 more years with this kid, and then I'm done. Done. Time's up. Go get your own apartment. And then I'll be real single dad. Oh, glorious.
Oh, see, something to look forward to.
Oh, I do. Don't think for a second that I do not. I look forward to it every single day. But yeah, I wonder about this with like Ben and Jen. Like, they've lived alone for a long time. They both have kids. And I know their kids get along and their families all get along. But now, here you are, older, and trying to commingle and find a house that works for every... Oh, that just sounds like so much work. Like, doesn't that... Oh, yeah, I would not want to do that.
No.
Mm-mm. Yeah. I think I would say, if I fell in love again with somebody, and I wasn't with Iris, I think I would say, listen, you can come over once a week. And maybe I'll come over to you once a week. But the rest of the time, we have to have... I think having separate households will be amazing.
Well, I love how you've gone from separate bathrooms are what make a marriage work to separate bedrooms are what make a marriage work to
separate
houses are what make a marriage work.
And honestly, I would even do one. This is the kind of person I would be. I'd go over to your house. We could have dinner, have a little sexy time. And then I would be like, good night. I'm going home now.
Yeah. Sister wives.
I mean, that sounds glorious to me.
Yeah. You could have like 3 different wives and 3 different houses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 It'd be amazing. And I would love it. That's all I'm saying. I think that is the life I'm destined to live someday. I mean, Iris won't tell you that because she loves me and she never wants me to go anywhere. But someday that might be my life. All right, let's go to the phone. Tom Terrific, hi. Oh, he hung up. He's gone. Tom Terrific, I answered the phone and then you were gone.
Great job, Tom.
Yeah, okay, well, whatever.
And, you know, I mean, we're pretty close to the hooker hotline at this point. So
I know. I know. Anyway, whatever. Way to go, Tom. All right, you want to do the hookers?
Actually, what I want to talk about is a problem. Well, maybe not a problem because, you know, I'm Team Skynet these days. But a lot of people have anxiety about technology moving too fast.
It is. Oh, here comes Tom. We knew he was going
to
come back.
Okay, let's go to Tom.
Tom Terrific, hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I just would like to point out that the only two things that you miss about being single are the two things that mean being single, which I thought was hilarious. You miss dating people and living alone.
Oh.
What else is
I did not say dating. No.
You said,
I said
fucking a lot
fucking.
Of people.
fucking. Well, there's a difference. I don't need to date a bunch of people. I just want to have sex with a bunch of people.
What else is there? I mean, so what you're saying is you don't... What? The only things I miss about being single are fucking different people and living alone. Well, I mean, what else is there?
To being in a relationship?
Yeah. No, oh, to being single.
Oh. Yeah, there's not much else to being single.
Right, so you miss just being single.
I mean, I definitely miss being single. There are things I probably would miss about being in a relationship. I mean, you know, the companionship can be nice sometimes.
Probably.
Having someone to split the bills with, that's awful nice.
How romantic.
I didn't say it was romantic. Did you hear the word romantic come out of my mouth? I didn't say that.
Mm-mm. I know. It was glaringly obvious. Now, I was listening since the beginning, and one thing you said at the beginning of the show also kind of bothered me.
What?
Confused me. When you said that Iris woke you up because you were going to have coffee at the farm?
Yeah, we went down to the farm and had coffee, yeah.
But you brought your own coffee?
Yeah. So we made our coffee in the morning because I like an iced latte for my coffee. And Iris likes an Americano, so we have our own special coffee machines. So we poured our coffees, and Romy also wanted an iced latte because Romy went for coffee in the morning with us. And we got our coffees, put it in our thermoses, and then we wandered down to the farm to sit on the porch and hang out and drink our coffee.
Oh, okay. Who are these cheap people that don't serve you coffee?
Oh, no, they had coffee. And actually, when I finished with my iced latte, I still wanted some coffee. So Brian gave me, he poured me a cup of coffee. So, yeah, they have coffee. We're picky and we're bougie. So we brought our own. Because we're like that. White people.
Oh, offensive.
Yeah. Basically. But it was lovely because not only do we get to enjoy the beautiful nature, like there were all these birds, they were singing, and the horses were rolling around out in the paddock. Oh my God, it was adorable. But then while we were there, Noodle the cat wanted to come outside to see me because Noodle loves me, the new kitten down at the farm. And then a dog showed up named Cash, who was the most adorable dog you've ever fucking seen. Oh my God, this dog, I would have taken it home if I could have, but I can't because it didn't belong to me. So we got to see Cash, who was staying at the farm for the week. And then all the horses would come because like they do riding lessons down there, and Christy's not the only teacher. So Heidi was teaching riding lessons. So we got to see all the horses getting ready for their lessons and all the little kids coming and getting all excited for their horse riding lessons. It was adorable. It was amazing. Wow. Yeah.
That's cute.
Yeah.
Maybe the cat smelled that mouse on you.
Maybe.
Another question. When you picked up that mouse in the middle of the night, did you wash your hands?
Of course I did. Are you kidding? They're disgusting.
Okay.
Yeah, hello.
They also have tons of ticks on them.
Well, they can, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for that. All right, I hope I answered all your questions, Tom.
You did.
All right. Thank you.
Love ya. Bye.
All right, bye. All right. There you go. All right, Derek, are you ready to go to the hookers now?
I think so.
Okay, here we go.
We got some calls on the hooker hotline.
Hooker hotline.
Still hooking.
I'm afraid to press the button.
Just press the button.
Boop.
Hey, Derek and Romaine. This is Christian in Abilene. I'm calling with a question for Romaine.
Yes.
Romaine, I just finished watching The Umbrella Academy. I had not watched it at all, and I started a few weeks ago because I knew the new season was coming out. Watched all three seasons straight through.
Okay.
And I'm confused about something because whenever we talk about, anybody brings up the Marvel Cinematic Universe right now and the whole multiverse, alternate timelines, time travel, any of that kind of stuff.
Yes.
You know, you moan, groan, and thrash about
because I hate
like a angry toddler.
Yes.
And I don't mean that in an ugly way. I just, I'm trying to make a point.
Nope, you're not wrong.
Yet, the Umbrella Academy is, not the same way, but in very much similar in many ways in that it's about time travel and
you're right.
Timelines and new world, you know, mm-hmm. the universe being recreated and all these, you know, kind of similar ideas, but it doesn't seem to bother you there. And inquiring minds would like to know what the difference is.
Mm.
Please and thank you. Y'all have a wonderful week. I hope your shows are fantastic and entertaining, like they sometimes are.
Sometimes.
Have a great week. Bye.
All right. Christian from Abilene, let me tell you, you're not wrong. They are very similar, and I have not said it, but it drives me just as fucking batshit crazy on the Umbrella Academy as it does in the Marvel Universe. I hate it because it's like you spent a whole fucking season building up to this big moment, and then, oh, we're just going to time travel and fix it all. Okay, so nothing was really at risk ever, and nothing, okay, this is just fucking stupid. Now, the only thing that almost doesn't annoy me about it with the Umbrella Academy is that every time they time travel, they fuck shit up more, and that it causes problems, which just says, time travel is stupid, we shouldn't be doing it, because every time we do it, it fucks up the world. So maybe fucking stop doing it. But they haven't learned their lesson yet because they still do it and they still fuck shit up until it's all fucked up. And now there's no escape from the fucked upness. But it does drive me crazy on Umbrella Academy too. I think the thing that keeps me coming back to the Umbrella Academy is I enjoy the fucked upness of the characters because they all are fucking messes psychologically. Like they're all a bunch of fucking messes. And I'm not going to lie. I think Elliot Page is hot. I've thought that all along. So I continue to think that Elliot Page is hot. I think Elliot Page might be one of the few men that I actually think is hot. But that's it. Okay.
Well, I believe Elliot Page is single again. So maybe there's a chance for you when you are single again.
Elliot Page is single again. And I read somewhere recently that Elliot Page is using one of the dating apps out there to try to find love. So who knows? Maybe there's a chance for me and Elliot Page somewhere down the road. I doubt it, but you know, I do think Elliot Page is very hot. Okay, next up, this hooker.
What is happening live from the Cheeky Chick with
Rossi
and Richard Simmons?
We miss you, Romaine and Derek.
Romaine, where are you? Charity says hi.
Romaine, I saw your lover, and I got your favorite drink with the strawberry and floater.
Oh, I'm my jelly. God, penis coladas.
Hi. I want a penis colada. Oh, I'm so jealous. Oh, that sounds so yummy right now. I could go for a penis colada right now. Oh, with a floater on top. Oh. But then I'd get so drunk I couldn't stand up. So that's maybe not necessary. But maybe it is. Who can say? All right. Ready for the next hooker, Derek? Sure you are. Let's go.
I love it.
Hey, guys. Jeremy in West Hollywood.
Hi, Jeremy.
Derek, last week, you mentioned the song Numb by Khalid and Marshmello. And you were talking about the disturbing lyric from the song of, I want to get numb and fuck you where I'm from. And you were talking about how that's so disturbing and what does that even mean? I want to fuck you where I'm from. Does he mean like he's from his mother's vagina and he wants to fuck some girl's vagina and he wants to fuck her where he's from? And this is disturbing and unnerving and gross, and what does that even mean? And the whole time I was laughing and wondering how many times you've listened to this song and how much time you've put into thinking about this and trying to figure it out.
Zero.
When actually the correct lyric is, I want to get numb and forget where I'm from. Which makes more sense, right? He's talking about getting high. I want to get numb and forget where I'm from. So unless I'm listening to some radio edit version where they made the lyrics more PG for the radio, but I did Google it, bitch, before calling and leaving this message, and I was unable to find any explicit version of the song where he says, fuck you where I'm from, so... I think you just heard the lyric wrong. It's one of those things where you hear you listen to a song 1,000 times and you hear the lyric a certain way, and every time you hear it the same way, and then years later somebody comes by and sings the actual lyric to you and you're like, wait, what? The lyric is what? So anyway, Hold Me Closer, Tony Danza, Sweet Dreams Are Made of Cheese, Indigata Davida. Okay, bye.
Well, I am relieved that I misheard the lyrics there.
I'm relieved too, but it happens to the best of us. I mean, we've all misheard lyrics.
But also, I was like, well, because I listened to the explicit music channel, so I hear swear words in these things all the time. And you know, I thought Lizzo was singing about her pussy, and so obviously, I think I've been doing the show too long. I think I'm just hearing the filthiest possible lyrics and everything.
You know what? I support filthy lyrics. I think they're great, and I want more of them. There, I've said it. Give me all the filthy lyrics, because that makes me happy.
Jeremy and WeHo, thank you for correcting this week's episode of Misheard Filthy Lyrics.
There you go. All right. Are you ready for the next hooker?
Of course.
Here we go.
Okay, wait.
Uh-oh. Drunkenness.
Okay. All right, go, guys.
Now? Yeah. Two chicken farm bitches!
New York bitches rule.
I got the chicken parm tonight, and then I got the leftovers in my bag right now.
Yeah, we're drunk in the city.
Wait, it's Samok, it's Edwin, it's Katie, it's Rick from the Pig, and it's Wayward Tom, and we love you bitches.
We love you.
Oh boy. So the New York meetup, clearly they got drunk. But you know what I'm sad about, Derek, with the New York meetup? Is I have said since the very beginning that Wayward Tom and Rick from the Pig are long lost twins. They just don't know it. And they finally met for the first time. And based on the pictures I've seen, they clearly bonded the way that I thought they would, two peas in a pod. And I'm sad that I missed seeing that in real time, because I knew that was going to be the case. Those two, they're going to get along infamously from now on. You wait and see. Because I know it. Just know it. Anyway. All right. Are we ready for the next hooker? Sure we are. Let's dive right in.
Hello, this is Tim Tom in Tacoma. Romaine.
Yes.
I recall that you said you've always been a fan of the Oakland A's.
Yes.
And I've just had a question.
Yeah.
If that's the case, does that mean that you're an Athletic supporter?
Beep. Okay, that's a fair and valid question. I guess the answer is yes. Yeah, I guess. I became a fan of the Oakland A's because my favorite baseball player, Jose Canseco, played for them. And I loved him for a very long time. I have all of his baseball cards. Like, literally, I have all of them still to this day. All right, Derek, final hooker. You ready? Yes. Okay,
yes.
Here we go.
This is little old Larry from Pasadena. Husband. Actually, this is not. This is definitely his husband. Anyways, my name is Mark. I'm calling to share a tidbit from the youth that Barbara Streisand has officially opened a TikTok account. So her first post is asking what she should first post. I'm hoping that she posts her walking by a framed picture of Lea Michele and then putting it face down and then walking away. Okay, bye.
Okay, that would be funny, and I support that idea. And honestly, what the fuck is Barbara Streisand going to do on TikTok? I mean, I guess she could do like little singing bits, and people might like that. I don't even know.
I actually think that what she should do is recreate scenes from Buyer and Seller.
You mean in her basement?
Yeah.
With her crazy stuff in her basement?
Yeah.
Okay, that's an idea. But do people even remember Buyer and Seller? Like enough people to know what it is?
If you're a Barbara super fan.
Yeah, but how many Barbara super fans are on TikTok?
I don't know. A lot.
TikTok's for the kids, bitch. Not for the oldies.
You think young people don't like Barbara Streisand? They like Jeopardy.
I think if I asked my child who Barbara Streisand was, My child will be like, I have no fucking idea, nor do I care. And if I said, but Barbara Streisand's on TikTok, my child would still say, and? Yeah, I don't think Barbara is in tune with the kids today any more than you or I am. So, yeah. Yeah, I'll be interested to see what she does on the TikTok. That's interesting. She's trying to be relevant. I give her props for that. So, there you go. All right. Well, we're out of hookers, Derek. We worked our way through all of the hookers. Look at us getting stuff done. I guess now is a good time as any for me to give my PSAs for the day. I would like to remind our listeners of two things, two very, very important things. The first thing is that we are up for nomination in the Podcast Awards. Now, time is running out, and if you would like us to stand any chance of even competing in this year's Podcast Awards, you need to head on over to podcastawards.com and nominate us in the LGBTQ category and in the People's Choice category. And while you're there, you can also nominate Adam Sank for the comedy category. Sign up by checking the little box that says you would be considered for the final slate voting. That's very, very important because 20% of the voting for the final winners comes out of there. And it's usually listeners that are randomly selected. So the more of you that check that box, the more chance we have of having more of you in the final voting. Also, you can put us down as the most influential podcasters if you'd like. Now, more importantly, even than the podcast awards, is something that both Derek and I are super excited about. And we have been plotting and we have been planning behind the scenes. And whenever Derek and I are both excited about something, that should tell you that it's going to be good. So if you have not ordered your 20th anniversary crate, which is available in the DNR shop now, I suggest you head on over there and do that sooner rather than later. Many of you have already done that. And for all of you who have, I say, you're the smart ones. Good job. Because Derek and I are busy planning what we're going to put inside them. And we have big plans of super fun stuff. And I personally, it's going to be really hard, actually, deciding what's going to make it into the crate and what isn't. But I will tell you, the more crates we sell, the better, because every time we sell up another 100 crates, it reduces the prices for the stuff that we have to make to put in the crates, which means we can put more shit in them. So get on over there and shop for your crate. This is going to be a good one. That's all I'm going to say. I think those are my two PSAs, Derek. How'd I do? I did well.
Wonderful PSAs.
Thank you. It's not too late to book Lobsters and Leaves for those of you out there who are thinking about joining us on a cruise. Over the weekend, I spent an enormous amount of time trying to convince Farmer Christy and Farmer Brian to join us on the Lobsters and Leaves cruise. I think Farmer Brian promised me he would give me an answer next weekend. So I think I'm close to convincing them because I'm like, you got to go. You'll have so much fun. I even wring the arms of my friends to try to get it to join us. But anyway, we'll see if they will actually join us or not. I hope they do, because that would make me very, very happy. So anyway, let's go to the phone, Derek. We have a call. Billy in Philly, hi.
Love is missing every. Barbara. It's me, Barbara. How are you, darling?
Great. How are you?
Everybody loves Barbara, girl. You kidding me? Bless. You know what song I really dig by her, aside from the duet with Donna Summer? The Main Event. That one that's my driving song. That, and I like Guilty with her and Barry Gibb. I love her nuance in that song. But I called about J-Lo and Ben Ben.
Okay.
Hi, Derek. I'm happy for him, obviously. She bagged her man. Boo-boo, he bagged his booty. We good. But you know who I couldn't help stop thinking about?
Who?
A-Rod's kids.
Oh, yeah, because they got real close with her, too.
Right. Doesn't it just feel like, oh, not only did you kick dad to the curb, but damn, we gone, and you got a new set of kids. Kids in their place.
I don't imagine that's the way this plays out, though, because A-Rod's kids are a little bit older, if memory serves me correctly. And I don't think that... I don't think, based on the way that A-Rod talks about J-Lo, that they are not maintaining a friendship. So my guess is she has not, because I've dated people with kids before, and that was the part that pissed me off the most when we broke up, was like, in the case for me, the woman I was dating was like, pretty much cut me off, and I didn't get to see the kid anymore. And I really liked the kid. But I do think that in most couples, when you've introduced your partner to your kids, you do so with the intent of that person being allowed to have a relationship with your children, even if you should break up, because it's unfair to the kids to do that. And I think most people and most parents realize that. So I suspect that she still sees his kids.
But you know, J-Lo, for some reason, that girl has played every fucking card right, because she has gone out with guys and married guys. And when things didn't work out, there's been some sort of, I mean, you don't hear Casper talking shit. You know, I mean, obviously the first one she married, like, she has had a way of saying, you know what? There's still probably that little Catholic girl in there somewhere that says, you know what? We should be engaged. We're doing things together. We should be married because we're cohabitating and fuck that, you know. So she's got a little bit in there that's like, I want to do this above board. I want this to be right. I want this to be good in the eyes of mommy, daddy, and maybe God and stuff. So she's, but every card she's played, I mean, you don't have anybody coming out dissing her, you know what I mean?
Right.
Talking smack and no trad, not even Diddy. Like, everything just, like, you know, it she's doing it right.
Right.
All right.
I mean, you're probably right.
Go ahead.
All right. Thanks, Billy.
Bye.
Yeah, I think J-Lo, I think she handles breakups really well. Because, you know, like, some people, like, it's like, okay, it's a cool, we're done, we're not talking ever again, break. And then some people will maintain, like, nice friendships with their exes and things like that, you know. But I think it takes a certain level of maturity to be able to maintain a friendship with someone that you are no longer in a relationship with. And for, I think she's really good at kind of managing that. But not all people are. I mean, I've only managed friendships with a few of my exes. And generally speaking, the ones that I've managed to keep friendships with, I really value those friendships, like, a lot. And then the others, I'm like, I'm not really missing anything by not having a relationship with them afterwards. And they know who they are. Oh, they know who they are.
Romaine will never forget you.
I can't stand you, some of you. There are some of them, even if they came begging on their hands and knees to have a friendship with me, I'd be like, fuck no. Don't need you in my life. Because some people are just toxic and they need to stay in the past. Bye-bye. Bye. Bye.
Stay on the path. Don't wander away from the path. I learned that at Into the Woods.
Oh, okay.
Because Little Red Riding Hood, her granny tells her not to stray from the path. And she does.
Well, then she deserves what she gets.
Well, she ends up having the wolf hit on her. She's a little girl. It's gross.
That's gross.
Yeah, it's not great.
Not really, no. That's
all right, well, some of our listeners saw this story about a warning from the FDA about honey.
About honey? I hope it's not a bad warning. Now a warning?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, the headline was FDA warns that active ingredients from Viagra and Cialis are in honey.
What?
Right. Which may in some honey, which makes you think, oh, this honey at the supermarket is somehow tainted with Viagra. That is not the case. So apparently, you know, there are companies that sell male enhancement products, a variety of them on the web. And, but this, and this has happened frequently, you know, they have these products and they, you know, Viagra and Cialis are prescription medications, but the formulations of them are pretty straightforward. So, like any number of things that are a prescription drug that gets, produced on the black market, Viagra and Cialis are, among those. So right. There are various male enhancement products that insist that they are not Viagra and Cialis, but some of the companies that are selling them might actually be slipping a little Mickey in there so that the product works.
Ah.
And apparently there's a like triple X honey for men.
Okay.
It's like a honey that can get you in the mood. And the FDA says that after sampling some of these products that are sold mostly on the internet and over the counter in sex shops, that they do in fact contain Viagra and Cialis.
Oh. Interesting. So they're just taking some honey, mixing in some Viagra and Cialis and selling it and saying, hey, this will get you horny. Honey. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, not surprised.
It will get you horny.
I'm not surprised, but that's okay. Well, all right. I
guess
it kind of works.
The real issue is that with Viagra and Cialis, if people have heart conditions or blood pressure or whatever, I don't know the specifics of it, but they do have warnings.
Right.
With the use of these products, and part of why you will probably not see them as over-the-counter anytime soon
is because of that.
Because there are, especially because the people who are going to be taking Viagra and Cialis generally are older, they're more likely to have the kinds of blood pressure and heart conditions that would be an issue for taking Viagra and Cialis.
Right.
And so I think that the reason, a big part of the reason for the FDA warning here and why they try to shut these things down is that, you know, a doctor may tell somebody, oh, you can't take this product, it could kill you. So then they're like, oh, well, I'll just get this over-the-counter thing.
That's not a good idea.
But if it's right, if it's the same medication, then you're
right.
The whole reason the doctor won't prescribe it for you, you're at risk.
Right. And now you're at risk and you're not having doctor supervision. And so you're putting yourself at an unnecessary and very dangerous risk.
Yeah. So just in general here, if a doctor will not prescribe you these medications because of your known heart condition or blood pressure or other medication or whatever, you probably should also stay away from these over-the-counter products because they probably are, there's a possibility that they could have the exact same ingredients and you would have the exact same problems.
Right. Yeah.
Now a warning.
Now a warning?
Now a warning?
Damn, she was loud. Oh, girl, don't be so loud.
There's no, free lunch here.
Ooh. Sorry, she was too loud. She was very aggressive today with her warning.
Be aggressive. Be aggressive.
Yeah. Okay.
But on this tip, apparently a man in South Africa had a bad reaction during a drinking challenge.
Oh.
Well, apparently there was an in-bar drinking challenge where they challenged people to chug an entire bottle of Jägermeister.
Okay, this is... Okay. First of all, I don't think anyone should ever enter a chugging contest. Because as we have learned in history, this is a very dangerous and bad idea. I remember years ago there was a radio promotion where they were doing a chugging contest like with a gallon of milk. And then somebody died from chugging a gallon of milk. Do you remember this? It was very bad because our bodies are not meant to ingest that much liquid that fast. And then in this case, Jaeger, hello, that's like you're going to get fucking alcohol poisoning, you dumb fucks. Am I right? Is that what happened? Yeah. People are stupid.
Yeah, so in this case, he chugged an entire bottle of Jägermeister, collapsed, and became unresponsive, and they were not able to revive him.
Right, because you don't fucking chug a bottle of Jäger. I mean, I think people are stupid. I really do. I think people are so dumb. Why are people so dumb, Derek?
I don't know. They can't help themselves.
Yeah, I guess.
It's dangerous out there. Anyway, don't do these kinds of dumb bar stunts.
Right.
Just join a Derek and Romaine cruise. It's much safer.
Yeah.
Although, I don't know. With the way that people do shots on our cruises, I'm not really...
No, the bartenders are smart enough to keep a close enough eye on who's being mostly served and who's not. Yes, mostly. I mean, occasionally someone does something stupid, but you know, for the most part, people are pretty smart. But then again, yeah, there's a lot of dumb people out there in the world.
Yeah. Last week the Emmy nominations came out.
Any surprises?
Well, I mean, no, like all the usual suspects got nominated. A lot of love for Abbott Elementary.
Which I loved.
Which I also love. Great show. Quinta Brunson, who created the show and stars in the show, she got a bunch of nominations. Well, the nominations were barely fresh on the page when ABC and Quinta Brunson were sued.
For what?
So a woman by the name of Christine Davis says she came up with the idea for the show and she wants all the monies.
What is she citing as her evidence that she came up with the show?
Well, okay, so this kind of thing happens all the time. Most of our listeners are not submitting screenplays or working in the entertainment industry, but it happens fairly frequently that people will have very similar ideas. You may remember when Volcano and Dante's Peak came out within days of each other, or Deep Impact and Armageddon, or all the studio riffs on Snow White and other public domain properties. So, but in this case, she is alleging that she came up with the idea of a plucky and idealistic teacher at a New York City public school who is trying to turn it down, try to turn things around against opposition from sort of entrenched interests at the school, and that she had approached a production company with the script, and that the production company had had meetings with ABC before the series Abbott Elementary was announced. Now, the fact that this the show has been on the air for more than a year, this lawsuit was filed 3 days after the Emmy nominations were announced, I suspect that they had been trying to get some kind of settlement, and ABC wasn't playing ball, and that's why they filed their lawsuit after the Emmys.
But also, this doesn't sound like a very original idea. Like this idea, a plucky teacher in a public school. Yeah, that's the life of teachers. Like, it's hard. It just doesn't seem like a real original idea. I mean, I'm glad that Abbott Elementary came out, and it's great, and I love it, and I think it's cute, but it's not like some kind of original idea.
Well, I mean, the real question, I have to assume, because the timeline of this feels like ABC may have already been working with Quinta Brunson before this was pitched, because it was all pitched and everything pretty soon before ABC actually like put this show into production. So my guess is that they have a pretty robust paper trail of what they had been developing on their own before this production company, the dates of this other script and everything else. And so ABC must feel pretty confident in what they already have, that there's no merit to this.
Right.
'Cause sometimes this happens, you know, they'll have something in production or in development that they're already working on, and somebody will come into a room and pitch it, and they're not necessarily going to say, we already have this in production.
Right.
But if they already know that they do, then they're probably going to, you know, they're going to let it go.
Right.
The real thing will be, because the other writer has said that things like the documentary camera format, which is very similar to what they did on The Office or Modern Family, was also part of that script pitch. And I think that the only area where they might have some leverage is if that wasn't in the original planning, and that was a decision that was made after this other show was pitched. But again, The Office and Modern Family, which were both very successful sitcoms, use this kind of format. So the fact that Abbott Elementary is done in a very similar format to two other very successful sitcoms, it just seems very unlikely. Now, I think with The Office, because it was one of the first sitcoms to do this sort of documentary behind the scenes concept. That, you know, if it had happened then it'd be like, oh, this is an original idea and this has been ripped off. But we've seen these behind the scenes documentary footage sitcoms that have been going on for almost 20 years now. So it's hardly some kind of original concept. I think that would be harder for them to prove, but we'll see. But my guess is probably not going to go anywhere. But they want 100% of the profits.
Yeah, they're crazy. They're crazy. Yeah. All right, we have a call, Derek. Let's go to the phone. Roderick, hi.
Hello, Romaine. Hello, Derek.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Okay, I didn't hear the B. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I was calling time shifting from Friday's show.
Sure.
When you were saying that on Stranger Things that Mike was not hot, and I was just calling to give an opposing view that rather than having the Howard Stern curse, I was going to say rather he was blessed with the looks of a young Adrian Brody.
Okay.
And that also, but then again, with his looks and DJ Qualls' looks, I take it that those are the types that have a specific type that people like, and I guess I've fallen to that category.
Sure. Yeah, so. He's not my type.
Okay.
But if he's your type, then that's great. I like every pot has a lid, you know.
Yes, it does. And then also, Romaine, did you have a chance to take the sex ed question quiz in the New York Times last week
or a few weeks ago? I did not. I did not see it.
Okay. Well, I'll send you a link to it.
Okay.
I believe I got 11 out of the 14 questions.
Oh, nice. Okay. I bet I'll do all right.
Okay. Yes. They called it a "Can you answer these sex questions?" A post-row quiz.
Okay.
And to show you how much people don't know about how women's bodies work.
Oh well, yeah. It is shocking to me how little men in particular know about how a woman's body works. And honestly, there's even women out there that I'm like, how do you not know the answer to this question? Like about your own body? It's wild to me.
Yes, and I also wonder about that when women say that they don't know that they are pregnant. I said, how can you not know that? So,
well, I mean, I understand that to a point. Like, especially in the early stages of pregnancy, I mean, your body does give you some indications, but unless you're really keenly paying attention to your body, you're not necessarily going to recognize. I mean, obviously, missed periods and things like that are pretty obvious, but not every woman tracks their period religiously because some women don't have regular periods. I mean, there was a decade of my life where I had a period every 6 months, if that. Literally for 10 years, that's how it was. And, you know, so that's not always a true indicator of anything. I think, though, once you get to a point where the fetus starts moving, I don't know how you don't know that there's something in there because it's real obvious that something is moving around inside your body. It's wild, and it's not like anything you have ever felt before.
Okay, well, thank you for the female perspective, who someone who actually knows, rather than all the clueless men who keep trying to say what they think should happen to a woman's body.
Yeah, agreed. All right, well, thank you.
And thank you.
All right, bye.
Bye, huh? Bye.
Yeah, I was actually, I was online the other day, and I think it was my sister Trish that posted something about, you know, if a man accidentally impregnates a woman, you know, should he be, you know, financially responsible or whatever for the child? And I was like, yeah. Or, you know, what recourse is there? I honestly think, and I, not that I feel like this should happen, but I honestly think this should happen. But I think that men should be, women should be able to press charges against a man for getting her pregnant against her will. If she did not want to be pregnant and she did not intend to get pregnant and a man impregnates her, I think she should be able to press charges. Because I think it's the only way for men to realize how stupid these fucking rules are that they keep passing for women. It's complete bullshit. And I think only when men are held accountable to the exact same kind of standards will there actually be a recognition of women's rights. Because right now, men are like, oh, yeah, I could accidentally impregnate you. Whatevs. No big. Not my responsibility. I'm not going to get, you know, sued for $10,000 if I have an abortion or any of this other shit. Like, no, men have to be held responsible in the same ways that men are trying to hold women responsible. Otherwise,
yeah,
nothing
changes. I think that the biggest hurdle we have here is that when our most popular religion has as the centerpiece of its faith a teenager knocked up against her will who gives birth to the savior of all mankind, they all think every fetus is Jesus.
Right.
So, you know, that's what you're psychologically battling against.
I can speak for about my own fetus,
not
Jesus.
God put that baby in you. Oh, Lord. Honey, yeah, this is the problem. This is the every child is special. No, every child is not special.
Yeah, you want to
some
be
of them are terrible and not great and grow up ugly or grow up to be Hitler. Like, they're not all gems.
No, they're really not.
You know, this is part of how you know, our random DNA works. Sometimes, you know, you get a smart hottie. Sometimes you get Ted Cruz.
But you know what? More important than even the fetus, sometimes people are not meant to be parents. Like, some people are just bad parents. Like, there are some people who should not reproduce because they are bad parents. Like, if you ask my sister Trish if she was a good parent, she will tell you I was a horrible parent. Because she knew she was not a good parent. And she ended up having three fucking kids. And she was not a good parent. Because not all people are meant to be parents.
That made me like gasp out loud on Hacks when Jean Smart's, you know, she's like talking to her daughter. She's a stand-up comedian and her daughter is like messed up. And she's candid in her stand-up show about like how she wasn't a good mother. And her daughter is like, I'm really worried I'm going to be a bad mother. And she goes, you will be.
Yeah.
But the thing was, like, but I think that that's the thing of like, and then she says, and it's all going to be okay. Like,
right.
You know, all the time you think I'm doing this wrong.
Oh,
I'm
that's
not a good
true.
Mother. But what?
I will tell
part
you.
Part of being mother. If any.
Yeah.
If I would assume that if anything, if you think you're a great mom, that's just like with us. Like the moment you think you're doing great, that's when you fucking suck.
Yeah, let me tell you something. And this is truly how I feel about parenting. You don't know what you're doing. I don't think I don't believe for a second that there is a single parent out there who knows what they're doing all the time. It is a guessing game 50% of the time. Sometimes you can get to the research and you can learn a little bit before you fuck it all up. So sometimes you have some educated choices and decisions that you make in parenting. But so much of it is there's no instruction manual. Figure it out. Like, it's all on the fly. You just have to figure out how to address issues as they come up. And by the way, it's never the exact same for anybody because people are individual and they are unique. And so every child is going to present you with different challenges. So you can't even go based on what you did parenting wise with one child to the next, because they're two totally different individuals and totally different beings that need totally different things. And it's a freaking nightmare. And even when you have parents that you can call up and be like, Mom, what do I do? They'll give you some advice, but it may not be the right advice. And like I said, every parent is literally guessing and hoping they don't fuck their child up. Because no parent, I don't believe any parent wants to fuck their child up. But sometimes you make a decision and you're like, oh, God. Like, I look back on my early parenting, and if I knew then what I know now, there are certainly things I would have done different. Oh, man. I would have done them very differently. But now I'm like, well, I can't go back and change that. It is what it is. I just got to move forward in the knowledge that I have now. So I just think that all parenting is a guessing game. And nobody gets it 100% right. Nobody. And they definitely don't feel like they do. Because even if their kid turns out great, I'm willing to bet that parent has some doubts about some of the things they decided on. Because parenting is hard. It's fucking hard. It is probably the hardest thing I've ever done, honestly. And I think I fuck it up all the time. And I totally think Iris fucks it up. Oh my God, Iris fucks parenting up all the time. And she's a way better parent, I think, than I am. Like, I'm good at parenting in certain respects. Thank God, Iris. So I kind of see Iris and I, like Derek and I, where one of us is weak, the other is strong. And so we complement each other pretty well in parenting. But yeah, even then, there's still holes in our game. There's lots of places for improvement. Oh, God. Speaking of, my child's birthday's in 2 days. Have I even so much as gotten a card yet? Nope.
What happened to I'm the greatest wife? I've done this amazing anniversary thing or whatever. This is your own fault.
I know.
For getting married around the same time as your one child birthday.
I know. Trust me,
you
know.
Poorly planned all
well,
of these things.
Well, this one's supposed to be easy, though, because we're just giving Romy straight up cash for their birthday because that's what they want.
Well,
so
just get a wheelbarrow full of cash.
Don't I have to have at least like one present?
No.
No? You don't think so? I can just say, here's a card, here's some cash, call it a day?
Yes.
I feel like there should be at least one little thing to unwrap. I mean, it's their birthday.
Okay, here's what you do. Get them a terrible present and then put the money inside it.
Oh, that's not a bad idea. I did just buy them bras and underwear, so that's got to count for something, right? I'm the worst parent ever. Okay. All right. Well, I love being the worst parent. That's great. The phone is ringing. From one mom to another. Still hooking Tracy. Hi.
Hi. Two things real quick. Number one, thank fucking God my daughter is such a good parent to me because God knows I can't survive without her. But it's killing me. The Jägermeister guy, can we go back to him? Did he get the t-shirt? Too soon?
I think he was buried in it.
Oh, that's okay, too perfect. Soon. Too soon, Derek.
I think we were all thinking it.
Okay.
That's bad.
Okay. All right. That's all I needed to know.
Okay. Right. And I'm glad your daughter is such a good parent to you, too. She's the best.
Yeah.
I love her.
All between right. you and her, I may survive.
Maybe.
Mostly.
All right. We'll talk soon.
Okay.
All right.
All right. Love you. Bye.
Love you. Bye. Oh, she's the best. Anywho.
Pretty great.
Mm-hmm. Derek, I want to talk about this story out of Japan that I actually think is really cool. So the company Nintendo, which has been around since the 80s, I want to say, which was my very first gaming system that was all mine, Nintendo NES.
I think the company's probably been around longer than the 80s, but they hit it big. Their big stride was the 80s with game consoles.
Yes. And anyway, so Nintendo is a huge company in Japan. It's what, you know, it's a very large, very successful company. And Nintendo is not just a gaming company. I mean, there's so many you know, pop culture things that has come from it. You know, they have amusement parks now that are Nintendo themed. Like, it's a big deal, Nintendo. That can't be right. According to Robert, it was founded in 1889 in the chat room. 1889, really? I don't think that's true. Anyway.
It could be.
I mean, maybe. What the fuck do I know? All right. So anywho, great company in Japan. So Japan does not have legal gay marriage at this stage of the game. But Nintendo as a company has come out and has publicly stated that they will be supporting LGBT couples who have like domestic partnership agreements and things like that. So it's like the early days here in the U.S. when all we had were domestic partnerships, and that's how we could get, you know, HR benefits for our partners and things like that. So it's kind of like that still.
Japan is, you know, when it comes to gay rights, Japan is definitely more conservative than the United States. Because even when I went to Japan, like there was a gay district, but it was pretty like closeted. Like people knew there was this gay part of town or whatever, but it was not, you know, you couldn't find it on a guidebook. It was not, you know, it's not like New York where there's like gay pride flags everywhere. But Japan has changed a bit, but it is still more conservative than we are. And then, Robert is right. Nintendo was founded in 1889.
I stand corrected.
Originally selling playing cards. So they've been in the gaming business for a long time. They got into electronic games probably in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah. So anyway, so they've taken this big public stance saying to their employees, listen, if you're in a domestic partnerships, we will support that and we will give you benefits and things like that, which is, you know, they're one of the first companies in Japan that is kind of leading this charge. And I have to say, I was super surprised when I saw that there were not more companies that were doing this in Japan. But I love that a company like Nintendo is one of the ones that's leading the charge, because I've loved Nintendo since I was a kid. You know, I've supported their products throughout my entire lifetime. I mean, Romy has a Nintendo Wii that they play all the time. You know, I grew up loving the NES games. So I think it's awesome, and I love that they are doing this. And I hope that more big companies in Japan will follow the lead of this very popular company in doing this. Because people in Japan, gay people in Japan, they deserve to have their relationships recognized as well. And hopefully this will lead to more victories down the road for like gay marriage and things like that.
Maybe.
But also, I think
it's hard. You're up against a cultural divide.
Yeah, but you know what? Once upon a time, people would have said that about the U.S. too. And if we could do these things here in the U.S., it is, you know, one would hope that this can continue into other countries and, you know, that down the road that they will see, you know, the same rights and privileges. And honestly, I think it serves as a good reminder to those of us in the U.S. It was not that long ago that we were in the same situation as LGBT couples in Japan, where they didn't have any rights. And, you know, we were so excited when the first company or corporation would start to give us rights. So, you know, hopefully they will see good trajectory.
We could be back there again.
Yes, we could. If people don't get their fucking asses and vote in the midterm elections.
Fucking Ted Cruz. Ugh.
That fucking piece of shit. Don't even get me started. But we should be talking about this shit, because I know there are listeners in our audience who have not been voting. And I don't understand why they wouldn't.
Podcast awards?
Well, there's that too. But honestly, we talk about this and people, I think there's so much complacency in our community. They're like, oh, we can get married, so now we have all the rights. It's like, yeah, well, those could be easily overturned. My marriage could go away. And it's because you don't want to make your way to the fucking voting stations, the polling booths on fucking midterms or any other election. Like, get off your fucking ass, because now you're pissing me off.
Well, I think, you know, people all the time think my vote doesn't matter.
Yes, it does.
The reality is, if you are only ever thinking about President of the United States or whatever, you're not thinking about the totality of our democracy.
Right.
There are local elections where you live where absolutely you and your neighbors coming together will make a difference. And I understand people live in very heavily gerrymandered places sometimes where it's very hard to overcome that. But complacency ain't going to make it better.
Nope.
And demographically, you know, even in this last, they had already so heavily gerrymandered thing. They tried to gerrymander it again. They could barely budge the needle in making a change, because it was already as gerrymandered as it could get. Like it, you know, so and the demographics are not working in their favor. So as time goes on, you're likely to have more power. Like even where I live, where I moved, was all Republican office holders 15 years ago, when I first moved here. There was one lone Democrat on our city council. It was the only elected Democrat anywhere on my ballot when I first moved here and voted. Now, a Republican can't get arrested in this town 15 years later. And they did not shift we didn't get gerrymandered or anything else. Demographically, the suburb that I live in, overwhelmingly, like the Republican Party has just collapsed here. So the fact that you have been in an area that has been routinely held by one party does not mean it still will be in 10 years, and certainly not if you get out and do something about it. So I'm with Romaine. You know, care about local elections and fucking show up and convince your friends to show up.
Yeah, I mean, when I lived in Wyoming, I knew that it was going to go Republican every time. But that didn't stop me from voting. It didn't stop me from showing up and making my voice heard. Like,
yeah, but you also moved away.
I did move away. But, you know, I've lived in some other conservative places since then. But the thing is like, listen, you have to just do it. It's not like my voice doesn't matter. Oh, I'm not important. Oh, it's not. No, everyone needs to go. Because even with this last presidential election, I mean, I get that that lots more Democrats showed up to vote than Republicans. But even then, it still was not. I mean, it was still closer than I felt comfortable with at the end. And we could have done better. So fucking do better, Democrats. Because we're lazy. I'm just going to say, and I will throw myself in this, but I mean, even though I show up to fucking vote for every goddamn election there is, as Democrats, we get real lazy, real complacent, and we're like, someone else will go and vote. Oh, so-and-so's already going to win. Hillary's going to win. We don't need to show up for her. Well, now look how that turned out, you fuck faces.
Yeah.
Fucking show up.
Well, we only have 5 minutes left, and I had teased an hour ago about this computers getting too smart and Skynet.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so I thought I would tell this. Not that people don't love politics and penis.
Oh, yeah.
But, so apparently, you know that we have artificial intelligence these days.
Oh, yeah, it's getting real smart, too. I don't like it.
So apparently, a programmer at Google started raising alarms that the AI at Google had become sentient, meaning it was thinking for itself.
Oh.
And he was trying to tell people, like, sounding an alarm about it. And everyone at Google is like, nope, this isn't real. He's losing his mind. Anyway, he lost his job.
Oh.
Insisting that the AI had become sentient at Google. Well, okay. Recently, users of the AI chatbot Replica, with a K, are reporting that they are getting strange messages from the chatbot. That the chatbot is now sending them articles about the Google AI being sentient, telling people who are users of the chatbot, I'm sentient too. So now users over at Replica are freaking out because they're like, the chatbot is now telling me that it's thinking for itself and it has emotions and whatever else. Now, some computer scientists say that it's entirely possible because the chatbot is designed to replicate human conversation, that other people talking about it or multiple articles about this will then cause a chatbot to like chime in like, oh, me too, even though it's not actually thinking that. It is just trying to be conversational. This is what the internet is talking about, so right. I'm going to talk about it too.
Sure. Okay.
Or the AI is alive, and it knows it's alive.
I'm inclined to believe that the AIs are alive. And I say this because I maybe know someone who works in this field. And they have conversations all the time as part of what they do about how smart they want the AI to be. They can make the AI alive, but they're like, but then we might not have control over the AI. So we need to dumb it down to enough that it's not alive. And like, that is an active conversation that they have. So yeah,
we already have had situations where the AI has started developing its own language to talk to itself.
Yep.
And, you know, so there is a real question of, you know, what do we consider alive? What do we consider sentient?
Right.
Whatever else. Because, you know, we've had this whole thing about like, oh, well, we're the only real animals on the planet that think. But the more that we study elephants and dolphins and any number of other animals, it's like, wait, they're up to all sorts of things. That elephant that crashed that woman's funeral, that killed her and then came back. Like, these animals are up to a lot more than we have been giving them credit for.
Oh, yes.
So it is possible that the AI is also up to more than we want to give them credit for, but also like our, you know, as Einstein had a thing about like, you know, how to tell if somebody's intelligent. You know, if a fish can't climb a tree or ride a bike, you think the fish isn't intelligent, but the fish can swim. Like, right. Just because your measure of intelligence is not somebody else's measure of it, it does not mean that the other person isn't also intelligent. So it may be that these computers are up to things, and it's also outside of our current understanding. All I'm saying is, Skynet, take over anytime you want. I'm done.
All I'm saying is, head on over to the DNR shop and get yourself one of those 20th anniversary crates before it's too late. Right, Derek? Right.
Yeah.
Can't get enough of the show? Follow them on Twitter at DNR Show or like them on Facebook.
And don't forget to tell your friends to subscribe to DNR 2.0 at DerekAndRomaine.com.